Chancellor Motte, I have the honor to present to you Lisa Okofa to receive the degree of Doctor of Science, Honoris Causa.
Irina Bakova, Director General of UNESCO, you have been a tireless advocate for quality education as a fundamental human right. First elected in 2009 and re-elected in 2013, you are the first woman and the first Eastern European to hold the position of Director General at UNESCO. That deserves a round of applause. And if you didn't know, UNESCO is the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization. During this time, you have worked tirelessly toward countering violent extremism and youth radicalization, achieving sustainable development, and empowering girls and empowering women. Not only have you made gender equality an organizational priority, you're also a leading figure in the fight against racism and anti-Semitism. You were UNESCO's first Director General to appoint a special envoy for Holocaust education. To combat financing of terrorist activity, you have worked to prevent illicit trafficking in cultural goods. You have also promoted scientific cooperation and advocated for the safety of journalists and freedom of expression. In addition, you have been vocal in your support for civics as essential actors for positive change, essential actors for dialogue, essential actors for inclusion. As you stated last November in your address to the Athens Conference in Welcoming Cities for Refugees, more than ever, you said, we must stand together for the diversity that enriches humanity and the values that bring us together. As a member of the Parliament in Bulgaria from 1990 to 1991, and again from 2001 to 2005, you helped to draft Bulgaria's new constitution, thus contributing to the country's accession to the European Union. For your achievements, you have received state distinctions from countries throughout the world, so that all may know of your tireless dedication and your vast contributions to global social justice through public policy. The University of Massachusetts Boston is honored to confer upon you, Irina Okofa, the degree of Doctor of Science, Honoris Causa. With our 2017 commencement address, please welcome, come on up, Irina Bakova.
Come on.
Let's welcome her to the roster.
For the honor and the distinction that you have bestowed on me. And I'm deeply humbled to stand with you today to receive this honorary Doctorate of Science. But it is also an immense pleasure to be in this amazing ceremony. Because UMass, your university, is a unique institution holding a singular position in the academic landscape as a public research university with a vibrant tradition of urban and civic engagement. But there is something more, I believe, that makes UMass unique. You believe in the power of diversity to widen and strengthen our capacity to create, to enrich societies, communities, and to stoke new ideas. Mixing methods and disciplines, cultures and peoples from all backgrounds. And now I salute you for that. I believe it is more than a philosophy. It is indeed the only path to nurturing global citizens, one that resonates with the heart of UNESCO's values. It is particularly moving for me to deliver this commencement speech as you embark on a new journey. And as I myself, as Director General of the United Nations Agency for Education, Culture, Sciences and Communication, am nearing the end of my second term of office after 8 years as the Director General of UNESCO. And I was just thinking, sitting in front of you, how times were different 8 years ago. There were global consequences of the financial crisis, underlying the fragilities of the interdependence of the world. 8 years ago, Twitter was a startup with 30 employees. It is now worth hundreds of millions of dollars, employing some 4,000 people. Snapchat, Instagram, Pinterest, none of them existed. Over the course of the last 8 years, events took place that none of us thought possible. For the first time, artificial intelligence beat the human mind in a game of Go. And we have seen the rise of smart cars and the big data revolution. After 12 years and evoking in a voyage of 12 billion kilometers, a tiny robot sent by a few scientists finally landed on a comet, returning images from the other side of the galaxy. On Earth, the map of the Mediterranean and the Middle East has seen other changes forever. In Syria, in Iraq, conflict has sent the region spiraling into chaos and suffering, affecting millions of lives, spawning the largest refugee crisis since World War II. We have witnessed the rise of violent extremism, fragmentation of societies, tearing down communities, striking victims around the world, including here in the heart of Boston, and just 2 days ago in Manchester. So, change, my dear students, is the only certainty today. So, my first message and my first piece of advice is to embrace change. To embrace change, but to follow the values that have instilled in you this great institution, the University of Massachusetts Boston. And please, listen and cherish every single minute you have spent here with this amazing faculty staff. And I would like once again to say, follow the wise guidance and words that were said by Chancellor Motley in the beginning of this amazing ceremony. So, I know this is not the end of your learning days. This is the end of your learning days here, but it is the beginning of the learning that you will receive further on in life, because education is a lifelong process. Everywhere I have been as Director General, I have seen an irreversible thirst for learning. People believe, as I do, in the power of education to transform lives, in the power of education as one of the most important public goods in any society, in any country in the world. I have seen this in refugee camps in Gaziantep, Turkey, near the Syrian border, where young girls shared with me their ambitions to become scientists, doctors, journalists, teachers. I have seen this in the Bakarka camp near Erbil in Iraq, in literacy centers in South Sudan, in Africa. All of them earn to learn. I heard this from women in Afghanistan, where UNESCO leads the country's largest literacy program. As Khalida, from the impoverished southeastern province of Paktika, put it and shared it with me. My family was hesitant at first about me joining this program, but I have learned so many new techniques and realized that as an Afghan woman, I can work together with men and serve my community. We need to take heed from global citizens like the young and very brave Pakistani girl, Malala Yousafzai, Nobel Peace Laureate and United Nations Messenger of Peace. She is a good friend of UNESCO, and I'm proud to say that I'm also her personal friend. She refused to give in to fear, to be silenced. As she stated during her Nobel lecture, and she often repeated, "I'm just a committed and stubborn Pakistani girl who wants to see every child getting quality education, who wants to see women having equal rights, and who wants peace in every corner of the world." So people like her believe in the power of education to transform lives, but sometimes it takes courage to make a first step. You sometimes need to put yourself back into the position of the learner, and this is not always easy. We like to think about education as a self-contained part of our lives that ends up when careers begin. And I can assure you, someday you will say to yourself, it is too late. You're too old to learn a new discipline or go back to school. But education is a lifelong experience. And I would like to salute most wholeheartedly Joanne Donovan. So inspiring example of a quest for learning, a quest for education. And I would like to express my deep respect and admiration to you. This is an example that shows us that it is never too late. And new fields of knowledge are opening up every day. New technologies, new ideas that can change our life course. Embrace knowledge, embrace creativity, never stop learning. In these times of limits, limits of our planet, limits of our nature that we are all living, limits in terms of climate, in terms of resources, education and knowledge are humanity's ultimate renewable energy. This is our only unlimited resource, and tapping it for the better lies in your hands, my dear young friends. This brings me to my second message, my second piece of advice. It is about sharing. If you want to learn, you need to work with others. You have to collaborate. to exchange. An African proverb says, if you walk alone, you go faster. But when you walk together, we go further. In the physical world, sharing means dividing. But in the world of knowledge, sharing has a multiplier impact and can ever lead to a gain for all. This is what happened with an amazing UNESCO project named Sesame, a collaboration of scientists in Jordan, in a small city of Amman. The story began 20 years ago, when a group of scientists came to UNESCO with a simple idea. They aspired to create a world-class research laboratory in the Middle East, just like the CERN Institute, an accelerator in Geneva, in Europe. Sesame is a third-generation light source. For those who might wonder, light sources are giant flash lamps coupled to powerful microscopes. They are used to study the properties of materials from the scale of human cells down to atoms, to accelerate research in biology and chemistry, from healthcare care to environment. So we launched Sesame because we believe that no single country, even the most powerful, can afford to build such giant machines on their own. You need sharing, you need collaboration. No single scientist, and I'm sure that the faculty staff here, with all their achievements, know that very well. Even the smartest one can tackle such complex issues alone. You need teamwork. And this is where that extra gain enters into the equation. In the case of Sesame, UNESCO brought together scientists from Egypt, Iran, Israel, Jordan, Pakistan, the Palestinian Authority, Turkey, Cyprus, UK, and US. All members that have their left aside their political differences in order to speak the language of science, a common language of science. They decided to share and to work together. So last week, I went to Jordan to open the Sesame Research Faculty. This is a giant step for science, but it is a giant step also for peace and diplomacy against all odds. This is the result of cooperation and sharing. Inasmuch as the initiative of the former United Nations Secretary General, Mr. Ban Ki-moon, who confirmed to UNESCO the establishment of United Nations Scientific Advisory Board to work all across the diversity of scientists from all over the world and from all disciplines to look at the science policy interface and to see how can science contribute to peace and sustainability. And I'm proud to say that one of the members of the Scientific Advisory Board, Dr. Maria Ivanova, is with us here today, part of the faculty of UMass Boston University. I think you have to be proud with this achievement as well. So, this, my young friends, leads me to my third and final advice. It is about openness and what I call the need for a new humanism today. You will be confronted with voices, and you are, some more aggressive than others, who claim that diversity is a threat, it is not working, that different people cannot work and live together. You will need to respond with concrete evidence to prove the contrary. And I am really so pleased to hear the wonderful words of the distinguished honoree here, the student of UMass graduating from US and Chile, who is working tirelessly to overcome these prejudices towards refugees and stereotyping other people's cultures. I think we need more of such work. We have to prove the contrary. We have to make more such initiatives to show that this is the story of all of us in different settings, in different cultures, in different circumstances. But this is also the story of humanity. I would say the story of humanism. And if you allow me, I'd like to share a little bit more on this. The famous French anthropologist, Claude Lévi-Strauss, a partner of UNESCO, described humanism as a quest to treat the other as a fellow human being, to put oneself in perspective alongside different ways of living and sets of opinions. Lévi-Strauss described three stages of European and world humanism. During the European Renaissance, humanists liked to compare their ideas, habits, and beliefs with those of the ancient Greeks and Romans to nurture critical thinking. Then, a later generation of European humanists and thinkers enlarged the scope of their research, spreading knowledge about ancient societies and peoples in so-called exotic lands to foster tolerance and openness. Finally, he found anthropologists then worked on changing perceptions of indigenous peoples to foster the idea of a single human family without distinction of race, age, and origins. Today, I'm convinced that our greatest challenge is to live together in this diversity. And I see this as the spirit of new humanism, to treat everyone on an equal footing, to make the most of our differences, to learn from them and work with people from a myriad of backgrounds. Here, I see this as a battle for the hearts and minds of people, predominantly of young people. We see the opposite. We see the rise of doctrines based on exclusion, migration, crisis, and conflicts are being exploited to stigmatize minorities, to legitimize discrimination. We hear violent extremists distort religion and history and pretend the world would be a better place if it did return to an illusory past when pure cultures lived alone. We see the destruction of heritage and the persecution of minorities in the global strategy of cultural cleansing. To respond, indeed, we need hard power, but we also need to renew our commitment to the culture of tolerance and acceptance of the other, to the culture of living together. This starts with our neighborhoods, in our communities, in our families, in our increasingly diverse cities. And this is why I believe your university's community engagement is so important today. A famous economist, Edward Glaser, described cities as humanity's greatest invention. For the first time, we know that more than half of humanity is living in cities. Cities are testing grounds for new ways of living together. And it is not by chance that among the 17 Sustainable Development Goals that the United Nations adopted 2 years ago, the so-called Agenda 2030 for Sustainable Development, one particular goal focuses on cities, on making them safe, resilient, sustainable. This is why so many of UNESCO's programs put an emphasis, a spotlight on cities, on learning cities, on creative cities, including here in the United States, Detroit in its design industry, also Austin, Santa Fe, for craftsmanship, textile, yoga. And of course, a very important partner of UNESCO is the United States Coalition of Cities Against Racism, which was launched by UNESCO with the United States Department of State under the leadership of the mayor of Birmingham in Alabama. So cities are about nurturing talents, sharing ideas, hosting universities, supporting universities and learning, strengthening democratic citizenship. In short, they are about empowering people and uniting us around shared values. So, I firmly believe we need to cultivate this sense of openness, of humanism, of empathy, of solidarity. It is not always easy, but there is no other way forward. We do not have a choice. I belong to a generation that lived in a divided Europe, the generation that had a historic chance to work to unite Europe again. I belong to the post-war generation, the generation that gave also birth to the United Nations. My family comes from a small town in southwest Bulgaria, in southeastern Europe, where 80% of the population is Muslim. And in cities in my native country, Bulgaria, like Sofia or Plovdiv, which are among the most multicultural cities in Southeast Europe, it is natural to see an Orthodox church, a mosque, a synagogue, and a Catholic church side by side, just a few dozen feet apart. As Director General, I have seen countries and encouraged countries to build bridges, like we have done in Mostar, in Bosnia and Herzegovina, where once again extremists wanted to destroy and did destroy the bridge. That did not, the famous bridge of Mostar, that did not have any particular strategic military meaning. It was just to destroy it in order to destroy the link between the different communities. So we at UNESCO will build this bridge in order to show that communities can live together. And I have seen all across the world an incredible thirst for dialogue, for bridges, for mutual understanding. And I saw this most vividly when I went a year ago to the University of Baghdad in Iraq with young students, young Iraqis like you, to launch our Unite for Heritage campaign, once again to build bridges between cultures, between young people over the internet. Because I do believe there is no clash of civilizations nowadays. There is just those who believe we can live together and those a tiny minority who reject this notion. So, in this debate, I think you will have to choose. And you can find inspiration in the great American story, especially here in Boston, the cradle of the American spirit. UNESCO bears the deep imprint of your country and its values. It was the American poet Archibald MacLeish who penned the lines that open the UNESCO Constitution. Since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed. Of course, it was in those days 72 years ago. Now, he would have said men and women. It was Russell Twain, American diplomat and father of the 1972 UNESCO World Heritage Convention, who said, and I quote, "At this particular time in history, as the fabric of civilized human society seems increasingly under attack by forces that deny the very existence of a shared heritage, forces that strike at the very heart of our sense of community, I am convinced that world heritage holds out a contrary and positive vision of human society and our common future. I believe my dear young friends, this has never been so relevant. We have developed formidable technologies. Change is transforming our societies at unprecedented speed. To stay the course, each of us needs to nurture a sense of common values, like the values you have shared here in the University of Massachusetts Boston. This is also the sense of new humanism to respond to the challenges we face. So, my message today is continue learning, keep on sharing, and stay open. Be stubborn, as the brave Pakistani girl Malala Yousafzai said. She's stubborn against the forces of obscurantism, against the Taliban. Be stubborn like her. So, good luck, class of 2017. Make us proud. And thank you for coming.